United States, nothing captivates or terrifies quite like a tornado. Documented in movies and across social media, this natural phenomena remains largely unexplained. Now, a group of twister-chasing scientists is on a mission to enter the eye of the storm.
They're doing it for other people, so it's almost like they're going into war.
Just how close can they get? And can they collect data to help unlock one of the natural world's biggest mysteries?
We need to start moving now, so before they get real nasty on us.
March to June each year is tornado season in the United States.
So currently, there's a big high-pressure system located over basically most of the central CONUS.
And at the National Severe Storms Laboratory in Norman, Oklahoma, this group of weather researchers is getting ready to storm chase.
Wichita would make a northeast Nebraska play difficult, especially for the slower vehicles like the radars that can't move that quickly.
Called Taurus, the project is at the cutting edge of severe storms research, and they're about to spend 1 month traveling the Great Central Plains on the hunt for tornadoes.
All right, we sure we want to do this?
Sure. Okay. Exciting first days.
I need three OU people to go fetch vehicles.
Sean War is one of the team's research scientists who's been studying tornadoes for 12 years.
What are you looking for when you head out?
So the objective of this field project is to understand supercells in general and what causes those storms to form in the first place, to produce the severe weather hazards that they do, and have a deeper understanding of how those interactions work. And with that understanding, we can translate that into a better ability to forecast which storm out of the day is going to produce a tornado. Is it going to be a big tornado or a small one? Is it going to last a while or is it short? And that helps us save lives and property here in the United States and everywhere, actually, you know, because the weather works the same all over the planet.
Making up the rest of the team are meteorologists from several universities and their students, some who are doing this for the very first time.
Have you been out on Taurus before?
No, I haven't.
Nervous?
A little bit nervous, but that, you know, you wouldn't be doing it just if you weren't nervous.
We're probably pushing with all of the teams out in the field at once. It's probably close to 100 scientists out in the field.
In tow is a state-of-the-art fleet of more than 20 vehicles, including drones, radars, an aerial unit, and 8 mobile weather stations known as mesonets. Getting it all on the road isn't easy.
So the meeting was at 10 and it's now, I think, 11:45, and they're still not on the road. I'm told it's organized chaos, but it just looks like chaos to me. Okay, first couple of cars are out and we're off.
While more than 1,000 tornadoes hit the US every year, science still doesn't fully understand why they occur. The exact triggers remain a mystery, and that's what the Taurus team is hoping to find out.
All around me right now, there are wind turbines and farmland as far as the eye can see. This is Middle America, and it's as vast as it gets.
The team will be crisscrossing multiple states across the central plains of America. This is where most tornadoes tend to occur, giving it the nickname Tornado Alley. And today, we're heading to central Kansas. At the first pit stop, Sean and the team must review new weather updates to narrow down their search.
Today's forecast is very complex. There's a lot of changes that are going on, so we're having to pay a little bit more attention to the observations and try to figure out where we think storms are going to form and at what time. And the idea is to kind of slowly, like, refine our target area to get closer and closer to where we expect storms to fire later on this afternoon.
With a fleet this size, it's hard not to draw attention.
We saw that big boy.
We got two of them over case. He's got big balls on the back.
Yeah, that's a mobile radar unit as well.
Are you guys a bunch of storm chasers?
They are.
do you not have enough in Nebraska? You have to come to Kansas?
I've never seen this many, like over in the parking lot over there with the big dishes. And it's amazing.
So how long exactly are we gonna stay in this car park?
So this is kind of the challenging part of field projects like this, is there's a lot of time waiting. I mean, we've had situations where we've been in parking lots just like this and we've been here for 30 minutes and then we leave. Today's more likely a couple of hours.
When the signs of a storm pop up, it's all systems go. Tornadoes begin with a thunderstorm, but not just any thunderstorm. It's an incredibly powerful, towering storm called a supercell. Reaching up to over 50,000 feet, they bring high-force winds, giant hailstones, flooding, and lightning too. And that's what we're looking for today.
Hey, you know they're reporting land spouts on that stuff to our west, right? Huh? Yeah, there's three reports. They tornado warned it based off of it. No, the one west out in the dry air.
We're not chasing land spouts, Sean.
It's rotating.
When they deploy, the tourist team will need to collect data on things like wind speeds, air pressure, and temperatures, as well as getting radar observations. This will help them unlock the secrets of what triggers a tornado.
This is a good sign. We've been waiting all day for kind of storms and convection to form, and obviously we're getting that now that it's raining. So we're in the right area, and now it's just a question of which one takes over.
So it's incredibly difficult right now to know just exactly what the tourist team are doing. I mean, we've been tracking them and crisscrossing across this territory all day. And I can't tell if we're getting any closer to what it is they're looking for.
But the weather is a fickle beast. And only a few minutes later, the day's chase is called off.
I just saw the radar.
They forked it.
They did?
Yeah, for sure, we're done.
Really?
Yeah.
So that someone has called it?
I'm trying to confirm for sure, but at least half of the PI group has voted down.
They've headed back.
Everybody's kind of sitting wherever they stopped, but they've voted to not continue operations.
Do we have a hotel room?
Yes.
We're staying
at the same hotel room.
Okay.
So that has got to be one of the most deflating ends to a day. For a brief minute there, I actually thought we were going to see something. I managed to get a storm, but at the very last minute, it just completely dissipated. It just goes to show what a difficult task these scientists have. Not every day is a bust.
Oh shit.
Filmed by tourists, this footage shows the team in action on a tornadic supercell storm. To get the data they need, they have to get as close as possible.
But I'm worried about this one.
Yeah, I am too.
Back at the hotel, Sean walks me through how it all works.
So we've got a couple of different vehicles. The radar truck is kind of one of those more iconic ones. I actually drive this vehicle, which is called a mobile mesonet. It's essentially a mobile weather station.
So how do all these different vehicles work together when you're in action?
So they kind of move around and they work off of each other, right? They can use their information together to form kind of a cohesive picture of what the storm environment's doing and how it's changing as we continue to operate on the storm. So like the radar truck, for example, that's gonna stay a little bit further away. It gives us a broader scale picture of what's going on. But the vehicles like the ones that you see behind me, their job is to get a little closer and, you know, more personal with the storm.
It's Sean's job to sample the area next to where the tornado forms. It's a tightly choreographed dance under deadly conditions.
A lot of times that means driving in and out of the hail core, a lot of heavy rain. So it's a lot of staying on top of roads, traffic, you know, weather conditions, that sort of thing. It's a very complex moving picture, and it's my job to keep the vehicle safe and as well as the occupants safe.
Copy that. Just be careful of the lighting. There's a lot of it around.
So if you're in an area that it's raining or it's hailing or there's active lightning or things like that.
This year, the team also have to learn on the job.
You zip tie it to the bottom of the balloon.
The mission was meant to use drones, but they've been grounded at the last minute due to red tape. So tonight, Sean and the team's lead investigator, Dr. Adam Houston, must teach the team's young members how to use wind sondes instead.
The challenge there, in particularly higher wind conditions, is to let go of both at the same time. Because if you hold on to one just a hair too long, particularly the sonde, you're gonna rip the sonde right off the bottom of the balloon. So try to get really good at letting go of both at the same time. Also keep in mind that it is immediately gonna start unspooling. So try not to launch in an area where you're gonna hit a tree or a building or a power line.
A sensor in a plastic cup tied to a weather balloon. It's a simple but crucial instrument. They'll need to be released during a storm to measure its wind speed and direction. And Adam is a little nervous.
I mean, it's stressful in different ways. They're simple, which is good, but to be able to do this reliably is an unknown. There's also the obligation. I mean, we're stewards of a large investment of federal money to do this, and if we don't do it and don't do it well, then, you know, they feel like the money's not being well spent.
Tornadoes cost the US billions in damage each year, so the government have invested heavily in the tourist mission.
That's kind of what you're looking for. Take this off. I'm gonna twist it a couple times.
Do it.
Tomorrow's gonna be a very steep learning curve. That's what tomorrow's about. Learning how to do all this.
Officials say this was the deadliest tornado outbreak in the US in well over a decade.
Making the tourist mission even more difficult is the fact tornado behavior is changing.
The harrowing images from above revealing the devastating scope here.
TV newscasts across the US report the intensity and locations of tornadoes are becoming increasingly unusual.
And one of at least 34 tornadoes reported across 8 states now. A very rare December outbreak, at least 90 lives feared lost.
There's been a rise in tornadoes occurring east of the central states in more densely populated areas, like Mayfield in the state of Kentucky.
So this is basically the heart of downtown Mayfield, and all around here is just utter devastation. I mean, what would have once been here are multi-story buildings, and it's just been entirely flattened. The trees have just been shaved in half. The tops have been completely removed. And this is 5 months since this tornado ripped through this town.
Ravaged by a tornado in December last year, the strength, path, and duration of the twister that tore through Mayfield were all unusual. It was almost a mile wide and stayed on the ground for more than 300 kilometres. It destroyed more than 15,000 buildings and left 88 people dead.
So this block here is just endless expanses of what used to be former homes, and right now they're just completely gone, they've vanished. And every one of these homes would have been somebody's life. And they've just been wiped off the map.
Hi, Martha.
Hi.
So this is what was your house?
This was my house.
On Mayfield's worst hit street, I meet one of the many survivors, 73-year-old Martha Thomas. She had lived here for 41 years.
So this entire street was obviously wiped out.
Oh yeah, about halfway down that end, both sides of 6th Street, 7th Street, 8th Street, 9th Street. And those streets had a lot of historical homes, beautiful homes on them. And they were just destroyed.
In what, a minute?
In less than a minute, yeah.
At home when the tornado hit, her house was torn apart around her while she huddled in the bathroom with her pet dog.
We could just hear it coming through. We heard glass breaking, wind. The wind was horrific. The people who describe it as a freight train, that's very accurate. It sounds like it's running right over you. The whole house was shaking. That room was shaking. And I didn't know if it was going to hold or not. So.
What were you thinking in that moment?
I was thinking, if this is my time, I'm good. I think I'm good. I prayed for mercy, you know. I didn't know what else to do.
Making the tornado even more unexpected is the fact it happened in winter and at night. This footage was filmed by a nearby resident. Nocturnal tornadoes are twice as likely to kill.
Lori! Lori! Get your ass in here.
I'm in here.
No, you're not. Get in here, get in the basement.
When I walked out and saw I had big plate glass windows in the front and they were all gone, and everything in the living room was turned upside down on top of each other. And I'm just standing in the hall looking at it. And my next thing to do was call my son. And I said, we've had a tornado. I've lost everything. And I said, you know, this I get emotional about. I said, I need you. He said, I'm on my way, you know. I didn't know how bad it was. At that point, I just knew how bad it was in my house.
Did you ever think that this could happen here?
I did not. I did not. And I think most of us around here and in Mayfield thought, this is a warning. It's not, you know, it's going to be like the rest of them. It's not going to come. It's not going to touch down. And we were very wrong.
There's a big reason residents in Mayfield didn't believe the warnings. Roughly 70% of tornado warnings issued in the US are false alarms. And that's because while scientists know what to look for to detect them on radar imagery, they still can't determine why one storm produces a tornado and another identical looking storm does not.
We can have a sequence of supercells lined up in a particular area, and we do not know which one of those is going to become tornado. And what we're hoping to do is to understand the supercell better, understand those that cascaded processes that lead to tornado genesis, and then take that understanding and put it in the forecast process. You know, 30 minutes in advance or an hour in advance, which of these storms is going to become tornado, because that's the lead time that people need to take shelter.
Back in the Central Plains, the team are tracking another potential supercell storm. This time in Iowa.
So right now there's a P3 plane, which is part of the tourist mission, circling overhead. And literally everyone is ready to deploy, but we're all just waiting for this supercell to manifest.
As they wait, another problem appears.
Honestly, like sometimes you almost feel like sort of like a zoo animal. Everybody else that's in this little town is like at the zoo and they're watching us. But and sometimes it's even like that with other chasers too. They see a mobile mesonet vehicle and they, oh my gosh, this is where we need to be.
The team don't just battle the weather. One of the biggest challenges is other storm chasers on the road.
Hey guys.
Hey, how are you?
I can't help but notice you look like a tour group.
Are
you?
Yes, I am.
How many people do you have in this tour here right now?
Today we've in essence got about 8 people roughly.
Yeah.
Right now, yeah.
And are they Americans? Where have they come from?
So I've got Americans and I've got one gentleman from the UK, and we take them from all over the world. Yeah.
That's incredible. What's the appeal, do you think, of storm chasing?
I don't know. Let's ask my guests. What's the appeal of storm chasing, guys?
The adrenaline rush.
The adrenaline rush?
Yeah.
Excitement.
Tell me about the adrenaline rush.
Ultimately, that adrenaline rush is better than sex.
Really?
Oh, God.
Really?
It's almost a religious experience. I know that's an oxymoronic statement I just made, but It's like, ah!
What can go wrong when there's that many people on the road?
What we call chaser convergence.
Chaser convergence?
Yeah, you get a lot of chasers, unfortunately, on a single storm or in a single area, and it's like a traffic jam. Slow vehicles, erratic driving, and that's probably the biggest hazard of chasing. It's not the tornado.
Both the amateur storm chasers and the tourist team think today's storm could produce a tornado, but only if very specific conditions are in place. As we hit the road, the team are looking for clues to help predict its behaviour.
Combo 1 to Combo 3, it looks like we're driving towards some outflow with this roll cloud you think ahead of us.
Yeah, we're trying to figure out if that's outflow or if that's warm front.
Rising warm air is one of the first ingredients needed for a tornado to develop. Another is wind shear.
So if you look up there, you can see all the turbulence associated with this.
How quickly those clouds are moving right now,
yeah,
you mean?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of shear. See, our wind's just shifted.
That's remarkable. I mean, in the time that we were just standing here, the wind was blowing into my face, and now it's coming from directly behind me. And just up above, the clouds are really moving.
Wind shear is fast changes in wind speed or direction in a short period of time.
Okay, so that's from, wow. Whose hat is that?
That has just dramatically shifted.
It's not long, and the weather shifts again.
So, lightning and thunder have both just started, so we're gonna get inside the car.
As the storm evolves, I get my first taste of what it's like to drive in these conditions.
We just passed through a hell of a ton of hail.
But as volatile as this storm is, it's not the supercell storm the team need to deploy. The chase is once again called off.
Every time we come out, we move forward, but yeah. We still don't have that deployment under our belt where we can say, okay, here's what worked and what didn't work. Yeah, overall kind of disappointing.
As tornadoes become deadlier and more frequent, a group of storm-chasing scientists are on a mission to collect data that could improve forecasting. After battling the weather for weeks, the team finally wake to reports of a tornado-warned supercell less than 1 hour away in southern Minnesota.
But again, I do want to note here that the motions remain quite fast with 60-knot bunkers right now.
But it's moving at extraordinary speeds. Around 110 kilometers per hour.
Boy, I feel your pain, Chris. It just doesn't feel right driving away from a moderate risk of supercell tornadoes, but I've been on the fence for this back and forth.
There are concerns. It's too dangerous to deploy.
I think it depends on your science objectives. If you can do something with a stationary deployment, If you can get enough science from it to see what one of those storms is like, then maybe it's worth it to try.
I think it's gonna be a data set that we would all want to look at, even if it's not how it was drawn up in the tourist plan.
If it's coming right at us, we'll bail.
They decide to give it a try. Because of the storm's unusual speed, the team can't chase it, so instead, they'll do a stationary deployment, collecting data as it passes over them. The goal is to get as many wind sondes as possible into the air. But it presents an enormous safety challenge.
these storms also have the ability to produce really big violent tornadoes today. So essentially it's going to be like we're playing chicken with a car. There's very, very, very little margin for error because it's one of those things that as soon as you realize something's going wrong, it's already gone wrong.
Now situated in the storm's path, the teams begin to deploy.
So things are moving really, really quickly now. We were just back at the car park and now we're heading again to reposition ourselves. The winds are really picking up. You can feel them pummeling the side of the car as we're driving along.
Adam directs the radar and Winson teams into positions further ahead of the storm, while Sean drives directly into it.
Let's see if we can take a look out the window.
Collecting ground observations on temperature, speed, and pressure.
Yeah, I'm starting to get a nice shelf right there on the edge. A little bit of action right there in front of us, just over the trees.
The rest of the team must now form a picket line.
Try to find spots that had good exposure to the north for Winsons.
This is Comet 1.
So I'm just gonna hop you and find a place further to the east of you.
As they get into position, amateur chasers begin reporting tornadoes. But they're 1.5 hours away in a different part of the same storm system.
Anywhere along this line can be in rotation. That one's actually moving quite a bit.
It's now all up to the Winson team.
How good's your mic? Sirens. Tornado sirens.
The young team have just minutes to get as many Winsons as possible into the air.
So right now the tornado warning is sounding in a town that we just passed through about 3 minutes from here. The clouds are moving very quickly overhead right now. It's pretty exciting.
So the potential area for formation of tornado would be down that way to our southwest.
Quite incredible to see. I mean, that's so much effort. What is really quite simple. It's amazing to see it launched up there. And that right there is going to give them some really crucial data that could help these guys figure out the mystery of storms and supercells and potentially tornadoes.
We gotta go, especially because we got a bunch of dirt roads to get out on. Yeah. We need to start moving now, so before they get real nasty on us.
The National Weather Service later confirmed 13 tornadoes hit Minnesota that day. They ripped through multiple towns, destroying homes, power lines, and trees. Luckily, no one was hurt. But no tornadoes were in the area where tourists deployed, proving exactly why their research is needed.
This is part of the challenge of doing research like this and trying to understand and better learn about how the atmosphere and the environment works so that we can better forecast these types of events.
The team went on to work the full tornado season, capturing data on 8 supercell storms and at least 2 tornadoes. With the pieces of this puzzle now in their hands, solving the sky's most dreaded mystery is hopefully just a matter of time.